Philip Massinger, The Jacobean and Caroline Age of English Literature, The Virgin Martyr, A New Way to Pay Old Debts, The City Madam, The Roman Actor. Hello and welcome to The Discourse. Philip Massinger was a renowned Jacobean playwright who not only succeeded as a solo dramatist but also gained fame as a collaborator of other famous authors of his era. With Thomas Middleton and William Rowley, Philip Massinger created a comedy titled The Old Daw in 1615. The Fatal Dowry was his successful tragedy co-authored with Nathan Field. With John Fletcher and Nathan Field, Philip Massinger co-authored the tragicomedy The Knight of Malta in 1619. John Fletcher and Francis Beaumont collaborated with Philip Massinger to produce the comedy Love's Cure in 1612. John Fletcher and Massinger often collaborated to offer comedic playwrights, and their tragedy The Double Marriage in 1619 gained huge success. Philip Massinger collaborated with Thomas Dacre for the playwright of The Virgin Martyr, which was a tragedy and was first published in 1622. Thomas Dacre was an old playwright, while Fletcher, Beaumont, Nathan Field and others were strictly Jacobean authors. Thomas Dacre was of the age of previous generation, belonging to Shakespeare, Marlowe, Nash and Peel. The Virgin Martyr is an important play because it was the first and only religious play of the Jacobean and Caroline era before the stages was closed in London. The play resembles more like a morality play of the pre-Elizabethan era. However, the subject matter of the play resembles more with saints' plays of Roman Catholic societies. It is surprising that Massinger and Dacre successfully produced The Virgin Martyr in Protestant England. The Virgin Martyr is the story of Saint Dorothy or Dorothea and talks about Diocletian, who was the last pagan emperor of Rome before Constantine's conversion to Christianity. The story is about how Saint Dorothy succeeded in converting the two daughters of Diocletian to Christianity despite his brutality. Diocletian instantly kills his own daughters right after their conversion because the girls not only convert to Christianity but also spit on the idol of Jupiter in front of their father, who is a worshipper of Jupiter. One of the successful solo plays of Philip Massinger was A New Way to Pay Old Debts, which was written in 1625. This play was inspired by Thomas Middleton's city comedy A Trick to Catch the Old One. Yet, it was a much more powerful playwright and proved to be hugely successful. A New Way to Pay Old Debts is a villain play, a drama in which the antagonist gains more center space than the protagonist, or a play that continuously revolves around the antagonist. Some other popular villain plays include Marlowe's Tamburlaine, Jew of Malta, and Shakespeare's Richard III. The villain of A New Way to Pay Old Debts is Sir Giles Overreach, which became a popular and recurring villainous character of English and American stages during the 19th century. The play is set in Nottinghamshire. The protagonist Frank Welborn and his dead friend's son Tom Elworth both have been duped and robbed of their money and estate by Giles Overreach. To avoid penury, Tom Elworth chooses to become a page boy of a local nobleman, Lord Lovell. Giles Overreach wants his daughter Margaret Overreach to marry Lord Lovell, as it would prove to be a very profitable relationship for him. However, Margaret has no interest in marrying Lord Lovell because she is in love with Tom Elworth. Frank Welborn meets Tom Elworth's widowed mother, Lady Elworth, and devises a plan to take revenge against Sir Giles Overreach. While Sir Giles Overreach wants to marry the widow Lady Elworth to gain her remaining estate, Lady Elworth and Frank Welborn pretend to be in love. One of Giles Overreach's acquaintance, Jack Merrill, informs him about the affair between Lady Elworth and Frank. At first, he doesn't believe Jack Merrill, but when he sees the two together with his own eyes, he again feels happy, as he thinks that if Lady Elworth marries Frank Welborn, then also he will be able to get her estate, as he can easily fool Frank Welborn again. He reveals his plans to Merrill and shows his acute villainous attitude to him. Jack Merrill gets frightened by him and goes through a sudden change of heart. He decides to help Welborn and Elworth against Giles Overreach. Frank and Lady Alworth, on the other hand, have no plan to marry. Lord Lovell comes to know that Tom and Margaret are in love, and he vows to help them get married. Being the page boy of Lord Lovell, Tom Alworth continues to meet and exchange messages with Margaret, and Giles Overreach doesn't oppose, as he thinks that Tom is exchanging the messages from Lord Lovell. To gain the trust of Frank Welborn, Giles Overreach mends his relationship with him too and offers him £1,000 to facilitate the marriage of his daughter Margaret with Lord Lovell in a nearby village of Gotham. He arranges a priest too to announce the marriage. Frank Welborn takes the money, but he intends to facilitate the marriage of Margaret with Tom Alworth. When Giles Overreach comes to know that his daughter's marriage is successfully performed, he becomes very happy, as he yet not know that she hasn't been married to Lord Lovell. Meanwhile, Jack Merrill steals the forged legal papers based on which Giles Overreach captured the estate of Frank Welborn and Tom Alworth's father. He gives those papers to Frank Welborn. Welborn meets Giles Overreach and reveals that his daughter has been married to Tom Alworth. Sir Giles Overreach's all dreams and plans shatters. He becomes aggressive and demands the £1,000 back that he gave to Frank. Frank refuses to return the money. Rather, he shows that he now holds the forged papers, and hence he again has acquired his and Tom Alworth's father's estate that Giles had illegally captured. Sir Giles Overreach is now a broken man. He decides to take law in his hands and draws his sword, but he cannot face Frank Welborn, Tom Alworth, Jack Merrill, and Lord Lovell together at the same time. He loses his mental balance and is taken into protective custody. Frank Welborn announces seclusion and decides to join the military in the regiment of Lord Lovell to serve the country. Lady Alworth and Lord Lovell agree to marry. Margaret and Tom decide to turn control of the estate of Overreach to Lord Lovell so that he may facilitate the compensation for all the people who have been cheated and robbed by Sir Giles Overreach. The City Madam was another comedy by Philip Messinger, which was first performed in 1632. It is a story of two brothers. John Fruggle is a wealthy, successful merchant, while his brother, Luke Fruggle, has been imprisoned and he is suffering penury. John decides to invite Luke to his home to live with his family. John Fruggle's wife, Lady Fruggle, is the eponymous City Madam. They have two daughters, Annie and Mary. John Fruggle has two apprentices, Goldwire Jr. and Tradewell Jr. Lady Fruggle is full of vanity and she has ruined her two daughters too. John arranges the marriage of his daughters with two deserving men, but Lady Fruggle and her daughters make those men run away. Luke starts living at John's home. While John treats him well, Lady Fruggle and her daughters treat Luke as a servant and often mistreat him. This fills Luke with anger and hatred. He decides to take revenge. He starts badmouthing John to Goldwire Jr. and Tradewell Jr. and incites them to embezzle his money. Also, he himself starts stealing money from John. John realizes that something wrong is going on, but he doesn't actually know what is it. John devises a plan to find it out. John announces that he is retiring and will join a monastery. He offers all his estate to his brother Luke. In return, John requests Luke to help three Indians who came from Virginia so that they can be converted to Christianity. After that, John goes away. After gaining control over the estate of John, Luke treats Lady Fruggle and her daughters with disdain. He forces them to wear coarse cloth and do household work to teach them humility. Meanwhile, John Fruggle and his two friends disguise themselves as Indians from Virginia and visit his home. Luke welcomes them and arranges for their stay. John observes all the acts of Luke. He comes to know that his own brother was stealing and embezzling his money. He also realizes that Goldwire and Tradewell are not trustworthy. However, he is happy that because of the mistreatment of Luke, his wife and daughters have actually improved and learned humility. At last, John removes his disguise and reveals his true identity. He takes over the control over his estate from Luke and sends Luke to Virginia to atone for the wrongs that he has done. The Roman Actor was a tragedy by Philip Messinger, which was first performed in 1626. It is a story of an immoral tyrant who comes to know that his own wife has an affair with an actor. Domitian is a cruel egomaniac tyrant. Domitia is the wife of Aelius Lamia. Domitian snatches Domitia from Aelius and makes her his mistress. Domitia doesn't resist much. Rather, she enjoys the power she gains after becoming the tyrant's mistress. The other woman, having affair with the tyrant, gets jealous of Domitia. Domitia, on the other hand, falls for an actor named Paris, performing a drama for her entertainment. The actor tries to avoid her, but Domitia uses her power to seduce him. Domitian comes to know about her affair. Paris asks forgiveness and says that he was forced by Domitia. Domitian pretends to forgive him. He then demands that Paris and his team of actors should perform a drama based on the same incident in which he will play the part. In the drama, Paris is supposed to be killed by the husband of the woman who seduced him. Domitian changes the false sword to be used in drama with a real lethal sword and kills Paris during the act of the drama. Later on, resentment against Domitian's capricious tyranny grows and he is murdered by the conspirators headed by the mistress, by his mistress Domitia. So these were some important and noteworthy plays by Philip Messinger. We will continue to discuss other playwrights and plays of the Jacobean era. Please stay connected with the discourse. Thanks and regards.